tank associated in this endeavor to produce interesting and original research. And we're very fortunate today to have the opportunity to have a discussion with a distinguished group of panelists about the forthcoming French elections. It is, of course, under ordinary circumstances, the political elections and presidential elections in a major European country is news, as a matter of course. In the current general political environment in Europe and in European-American relations and beyond, this acquires even more meaning because of a number of, I would say, novelties, if you wish, that characterize the current French political environment and that also, to some extent, certain trends that go beyond France itself and that really seem to apply to the broader European context. Without trying to overshadow what the panelists are going to say on this, it is quite clear that the traditional political parties in France are not, playing the role that they normally would, that is being the leading forces and fielding the leading candidates. This doesn't seem to be the case right now in this political cycle, and that's something that the panelists will address. But beyond that, all this is happening in a climate of malaise in Europe that is more than just France. That is, as the headline of our event indicates, it's about, rising nationalism, but that's not the only thing. It's just one of the key elements of new currents or undercurrents in Europe. That is the rise of non-traditional anti-system parties that seem not to like much of anything of what's going on or the traditional setup of Europe. That is the general political consensus on welfare state, moderate capitalism, if you wish, pro-European drive, faith and confidence in the European integration process, and generally the European model would be enlightened, progressive, open, tolerant societies. This is kind of the general idea that people would associate about Europe as a reasonably well-orchestrated process, which is also leading to further integration. And as the history of Europe indicates, from market to community to union, and this is where we're headed. Well, the French political elections and the rise of the non-traditional parties indicates that consensus is at best frayed, maybe, according to some, irreparably broken. But that's this is just to create a little bit of context. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our experts today who will tell us what they think about France and beyond France, similar developments in Europe. We have, I will not read all the bios, they are all in this sheet that you all have, so I will not go through all the details, but suffice to say that all of them have interesting, very interesting background, whether it's in government, in the private sector, in the media, or other specialized activities that make them informed and keen observers of the French political scene and beyond. So we have here Jean-François Boittin, we have Joseph Bahout, I hope I pronounced this correctly, and Michele Langevine Leiby. So with your indulgence, we will commence. We will start with Jean-François. Thank you.
Thank you, Paolo, and thanks for inviting me to be part of this panel. I think we agreed, since I'm the oldest one on the panel, that I would cover the historical part. How the hell did we come here? How the hell? Because we are like 10 days away from the French election. There is a high uncertainty of who is going to make it to the second round of the election, number one. And what's also striking is that the two people who are currently, underline currently, leading in the polls are Marine Le Pen and Emmanuel Macron, who are two outsiders. I would question the outsider qualification for Marine Le Pen, who is a trained politician who has done nothing but politics in her life, and who has inherited a party from her dad. But Macron definitely is an outsider, despite his banker past and all. So how did we get to that situation? I will be totally unfair, and I will, number one, blame it on the heritage of the president who was elected in 1981, François Mitterrand, and number two, blame it on his successors as well. So why do I say we are seeing the consequences of Mitterrand's policies and politics? Policies, because after promising essentially radical change in macroeconomic policy in France in 1983, he made a slight 180-degree turn, switched to politique de la rigueur, which in the minds of lots of voters meant that there was not much difference between center-right and center-left. It's introduced a lot of confusion. On top of that, his main political goal, as he was elected with a government which was a mix of socialist and communist, his main goal was to weaken the Communist Party, and he weakened it to the point of essentially killing it. And if you look now at the voters who vote for the Front National in northern France, in eastern France, these are the areas where manufacturing has been hit not as hard as it has been here in Pennsylvania or in the Appalachia, and these people now are voting for the Front National. And by the way, at the time, François Mitterrand also was helpful in helping develop the electorate of the National Front, because he saw it as the best way to weaken the center-right and split the vote among the center-right's voters in France, and he has been successful probably beyond belief. Top of that, the joke when I was in Paris at the time where he left power was that this man was so honest that he would let or leave the Socialist Party in the state where he had found it, which is nowhere to be seen. And that's exactly what's happening in the current election, where Benoît Hamon, who is the candidate of the Socialist Party, is now under 10% in the polls. So, maybe unfair, but I think it explains a lot of what's happening today. And the other thing I think which explains what's happening today is that after him, we have had a number of presidents who have been, for one reason or another, rather weak. Jacques Chirac was elected as a center-right. UFP at the time was essentially what we call in France a leftist radical, a radical de gauche, which is effing but radical. So did not want to antagonize anybody, no significant reforms. And because of at several occurrences, we had this mix of president of the center-right or center-left, but a majority at the National Assembly on the opposite
side, something that happens often in this country. We have had essentially very little progress made on several fronts, in particular in terms of social reforms. And I think for a lot of the voters, a sort of blurring of the lines between center-right and center-left. If you had the fact that our two last presidents seem to be straight out of the good old Commedia dell'arte of the 17th century. We had one Harlequin, and then we had one Pierrot. And these two figures definitely do not add to sort of support for the old political system, and probably explain why this enthusiasm for new, actually in one case fairly old, sadly old, but we'll maybe come that, back to that later, solutions that apparently now have the most support among the French electorate.
Thank you so much for the general overview, and now for some more pointed observations about the French change of the, let's say, the general consciousness, of national consciousness. Please,
thank you for inviting me today. I'd like to talk about the changes in France, in the French culture over the last 50 years or so. Many people are familiar with the movement in the 60s, 1968 in France, where students and observers saw France go from a very conservative and hierarchical culture to a desire for more individual freedom, for more individual expression, and I think the motto at that time was "identity, but the idea was that people should have much more freedom in their own expression, and authority was not really very well viewed at that time, police or hierarchical government. And that was really the mood that was still predominant, I would say, in the 90s and in the early 2000s. But with the dawn of terrorism, social unrest, and economic fears, I think people have become much more open to the idea of more governmental controls to combat things like terrorism that have really destabilized the country. The national identity, I think, is much more, I don't want to use the word patriotism as we know here in America, but the cultural identity in France has become much more pronounced over the last 20 years. I think when Jean-Louis Le Pen ran for president, it was shocking at that time that he made it to the sixth round. Over time, the Front National has become much more mainstream. And I think this is mostly because they've changed their argument from one of straight racism, which was very obvious and very ugly, and no one really wanted to be affiliated with that, the majority did not, to a question of cultural preservation, to a question of no culture is better or worse, but in France, we are French, and we do things the French way. That has been much more palatable to people who would not have readily identified with a straight racist point of view. Now, Marine Le Pen has done a lot, I think, think she has done a wonderful job of normalizing and mainstreaming the views of the Fourth Nationalism. And because of the focus going from very blatant racism to a preservation of culture, and now especially with immigration at a high, and fears from the culture being taken over by outsiders, it's become more acceptable, I think, over the last several years to, because, you know, if you're going to develop your culture, there's nothing wrong with wanting to preserve your culture. That's more easily digested view. So France, I think, is going through a major cultural shift that I haven't seen in my lifetime. And it's hard to say at this point where the culture will end up in the next five or 10 years. What's interesting is that France now being part of Europe, whether France will leave Europe or not, I don't think that that's a feasible option at this point to leave Europe. And because economically it would engender instability and possibly more unemployment and underemployment, which is really the main, I think one of the main reasons that Marine Le Pen has surged in popularity. It remains to be seen whether she has what it takes to become president. I think many people don't really think that that's a real possibility. However, regardless of how the election turns out, she will have moved the Front National more toward being a major political force in France, even if she does not win. It has gone from a marginalized party to a party that will become much more accepted in the future.
Thank you very much. And I think this is worth noting, that indeed what was considered, you know, extreme is now almost normal, you know, that is acceptable. And I think this is a really important notation, that certain political ideas that were certainly no-no in, you know, certainly in the 1960s, 1970s, or even much more recently, are now considered, you know, reasonably part of the mainstream. Anecdotally, I will cite, you know, one of the political parties of this same mold, Italy, the Lega Nord, which is now turned to real racist, xenophobic party, in which a member of parliament called repeatedly sitting minister in what was a, you know, center-left coalition government a few years ago, because she had to be originally from the Congo DRC, so she was obviously from African descent, even though she was obviously extremely competent, I believe, a surgeon, and therefore, you know, in the cabinet for good reasons, and referred to her publicly as a monkey. And this was perfectly okay, not perfectly okay, but he was not, you know, tarred and feathered and sent out of town. No, this was his opinion, and he repeated it many times, which is to say that the political discourse has become different, and therefore acceptance of what was considered definitely unacceptable is, you know, it's out there. Anyway, but enough of that, and I would like now to hear from our third panelist, Joseph, who will give us a little more texture and detailed overview of the French political scene and the eve of the election. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for having us. In fact, in the line of what you are saying, in fact, we can see resonances of what you just described even here in the U.S. in the last election. So I think that this is really a global Western trend of tremendous shift, in fact, in the political culture and political landscape. But this is maybe a discussion we'll have later. In fact, to try to put some political concrete context to what already has been said, put to the French election in their conceptual, let's say, parameters, I would say that this election is, of course, resembling to any others, and as you said, the first panelist, reminded us of the historical trend, but at the same time, there are real differences this time. I mean, there are new factors and new parameters. I would single out maybe three or four very interesting changes that had occurred recently and that very directly inform, in fact, the French election of today. The first one is the security climate, which is new. I mean, we never had an election in such a security or insecurity climate in Europe and in France. To counter, let's say, the long-ranging effects of the terrorist attacks in France that has started, in fact, in 2012, the attack in Toulouse first, and then Bataclan in Paris, Charlie Hebdo, and other attacks that were really very spectacular. And, of course, in the wake and with the background of the Syrian crisis, the Iraqi crisis, the rise of ISIS, the flow of migrants, which is a bit over-exaggerated in the media, but that is real. All this have put a climate that is very, very different from any other previous election. And I think that this will, of course, have an impact. At least it explains a little bit the rise of forces like Marine Le Pen. The second also important parameter that is changing a lot the givens in France is that we are still living in a country that is suffering from the effects of the economic crisis of 2008, the subprime crisis here in the U.S. that soon became an international crisis, but in Europe that took very specific forms and shapes. I mean, you had the bankruptcy of a country, Greece, that is completely collapsed today. You have countries that are on the verge of collapse, Italy, Spain, Portugal, and France, which is in fact really tittering, close to a kind of economic, let's say, very deep disruptance of its cycle. So this is also a new given that we haven't seen before. I mean, this is the first time elections are really occurring while we are still in the bottleneck of the crisis, although the last 2 years have seen a return of growth, which is very, very shy. The third element, which is very important, and the first speaker alluded to that or talked about that, I will maybe say a few words about it, is that you have the traditional parties in France in the political landscape or the chessboard that are completely eroded. They are bankrupt, if you want to call it this way, in terms of ideology, but they are eroded in terms of appeal, and this is seen in the number. France is not like the US, is not a bipartisan system. It is a multi-partisan system, but in fact, due to the electoral system, which is a majoritarian one round on a uninominal district, in fact, it boils down to a bipartisan system in a way. You have broadly the parties of the left and the parties of the right. This is one of the pillars of the architecture of what we call the Fifth Republic, the constitution under which France is living. However, the sociology, the political sociology of the country has completely revised that system. So we still have technically a two-party system, but in fact, the country is much more diverse sociologically. The offer, the political land is much more diverse than the political offer, which leads to something, for example, very striking if you look at the numbers. If you take the two mainstream parties, as if you were talking about the Republican and the Democratic Party in the U.S., meaning the Socialist, Socialist Party, and the Republican, the main party on the right, who are the big parties that were supposed to subsume together the entirety of the political spectrum. Today, if you add the electorate of these two parties, they are not exceeding 30%. So meaning that the two main parties in France are only one-third of the vote, which is very, very bad. Last point of context, which is very interesting, and you said it, Mr. Chairman, is the fact that for the first time also, or more than any other time, this election has really international and mainly European resonance. And the fact that France's elections, which are usually something that's not very interesting from the international opinion, you barely have articles in The Guardian or The New York Times or The Economist on French election. This time you have articles because it's not anymore a French election. It is like the German next elections. It's like the Netherlands election. It's like Brexit. It is something that is really posing huge challenges to the Western world. This election is occurring after Brexit, meaning that the fate of Europe is seriously at stake this time. This election is happening almost a few month interval with the German election, and with Brexit and Great Britain out, it means that the Franco-German couple is now the main pillar of the survival of Europe, if it has to survive. And then you have, of course, other things like, for example, the very strong erosion of Brussels as a system, the European Union, which is very much delegitimized in the mind of voters. So this is the general context. Now, a very quick word, if you allow me, on the given, on the technical given. What are we talking about? I mean, the elections are next week, on 23rd of April. Who is going to vote for whom? What are the givens? What is the landscape? You have 11 candidates on paper. Of course, some of them have in the polls less than 1%, so we discount most of them. So you have 11 candidates. Then you have the real candidates, who are in fact 5 candidates. Interestingly, you have 2 on the real right and 2 on the real left, i.e. on the real right, of course, you have Marine Le Pen, who is the extreme right, and then François Fillon, who is the Republican right, is eroded out because of the scandals and the affairs that are pursuing him. On the left, you have the mainstream socialist candidate, who is Benoît Hamon, who is eroding a lot in parallel to the erosion of his party, and the rising far-left candidate, who is not mentioned a lot, but who is becoming very interesting because he's rising more and more, catching up with the front-runner, who is Jean-Luc Mélenchon, who in fact represents something very odd in today's Western political landscape. He is a kind of remnant of old Marxist-Stalinist left, which is in fact very also telling in a Western world where these ideologies and political cultures are supposed to have completely vanished. And in the center, you have this kind of UFO, of unidentified political flying object, who is Emmanuel Macron, who is in fact the front-runner, probably the favorite of the polls and of the voters, but who in fact come from a very, let's say, fragile political background. Because Macron is someone who is both leftist and rightist. He belonged to the government of François Hollande on the left, but he comes from a banking professional experience, so he's more on the right on that level. He's very young, he's 38 years old. He doesn't have governance experience. And in fact, a lot of hopes, but also a lot of unknowns are projected on him. So to cut it short, I would say that if you take today's the poll of today, okay, we can't project what will happen in a week, but today the polls are giving a duel in the second round between Marine Le Pen and Emmanuel Macron. If you take the two personalities, these two people are outside the establishment as we define it. They don't have political governance experience. They never led, in fact, anything. And more or less, they represent a kind of protest against the way politics was done so far. Now, many people are saying, when they see that there's a danger or a risk or for some a chance, it's my opinion, of course, seeing Marine Le Pen elected, they say this is maybe the French replica of Trump, Hillary Clinton. I think this is a very simplistic depiction. First of all, Marine Le Pen is not Trump, for obvious reasons, at least the gender issue. And second, I think that Macron, if you want to find a comparison in the US to him, I wouldn't say it's Hillary Clinton 2016, it's much more Barack Obama 2008. So I think that this is, in fact, the choice that French electorate have so far. I'm putting aside, of course, the black swan, which is the sudden rise of Jean-Marie, Jean, Jean-Luc Mélenchon that could disrupt the whole game, and then you will have a second round between either Marine Le Pen and Jean-Luc Mélenchon, or between Emmanuel Macron and Jean-Luc Mélenchon. But then we come back to the same conclusion. These are three, in fact, outsiders, unknown, and they don't have, in fact, a legislative majority to govern with in the aftermath of the election, which is a question that I will probably talk about more at length in the Q&A or later on. So this is, in fact, given that we are living it. It's an election that is very crucial to France for obvious reasons, but I think, and without exaggerating, that it's an election that is very crucial for the future of Europe, that will die maybe after this election, and probably also because of that, for the future of the Western world as we know it. Thank you.
I could just add.
Absolutely, please.
I could just add one point to what you were saying about diminishment of regional parties. If you look at Emmanuel Macron, he does not have the backing of any large political traditional party at all. Even just a few years ago, that would have been absolutely unheard of, impossible. If you can imagine in the U.S. election, someone who is an independent, who could, you know, become a front runner in the election, it just boggles the mind. So that it's interesting to see that this is such a it's not like unlike anything that we've ever seen.
Thank you. Well, thank you for this general. Thank all of you analysts for this general overview. Let me throw a couple of things here. You know, just for discussion, for your additional comments, and then later we'll hear from the audience and their questions. In the past, we look at issues, you know, beyond the French borders. It used to be the case that when there were issues and that there were problems within some European societies, the idea was, well, Europe will take care of this. In other words, what is the solution to all this? More Europe, right? Deepening of European integration. So that whatever the dynamics or the tensions would be, that Europe kind of would be this kind of a welcoming safe harbor that would manage to homogenize the societies and take care of the issues with a sort of enlightened vision of this further integrated community. Now, the problem is Europe. And many of the candidates, not Macron, obviously, but the others are simply not willing, even Fillon, before his scandal, by the way, for those of you who are not familiar with all the details, just very quickly, he being the candidate of the heirs of De Gaulle, I would say, you know, great-grandchildren, I guess, in a kind of a loose way, that I would recant, but he was enmeshed in this scandal when it came out that his wife and family were on payroll, on his personal payroll, for many years as a member of parliament, essentially doing nothing. And so this became a huge scandal, and his position from being potentially the front runner or the main challenger to Le Pen and a good candidate for the second round, then was deflated immensely, and then there were other bits and pieces, including, correct me if I'm wrong, the fact that he accepted, you know, gifts of sartorial issues, meaning that he got handmade suits for the value of 13,000 euro, which is quite significant for a couple of suits, but he politely said that he gave them back.
So they're wearing.
So maybe were discounted. I don't know. They ended up with some convenience, whatever. So that's the story of Lyon.
And this is actually very funny because he was viewed, I think, as the rightful heir.
He was strong and pure and moral and ethical and all those things. And then look, the whole thing collapse. So you've got this trend, therefore, and I think it's important because this is becoming to point at Europe as the source of problems and of all the ills of the society has become very fashionable, not just in France, but in Italy, in Spain, in Greece, of course, being an extreme case because of its, you know, as it's been mentioned, the state of virtual bankruptcy and
now alive on respirator because of enormous amount of loans that will never be paid back. But Greece is really an outlier in terms of the severity of its own crisis. But this has become the fashion. But let me add another point here, which we chatted briefly, you know, with my colleagues here before the panel. What is very interesting is also the issue of immigration. Of course, immigration, you know, has sort of resonance here in the United States because it's been, you know, a theme aired frequently, as you all know, during the presidential campaign in the United States. All this problem, all these immigrants, you know, what are we going to do? Deport everybody, the wall, you know, Mexico, all these things you know about. But what is interesting is that in Europe, the problem, if anything, is more severe in terms of the intensity in which it is felt and in which it is magnified and in which it resonates with these political forces that gain support, not just the National Front in France, but other political forces across Europe. I came across a couple of polls, which I would like to, you know, offer to your comment, which are quite interesting. The percentages, again, in France, if this analysis is accurate, of the Muslim population in France is about 11%. Right? That's, I don't know if the number is totally accurate, give or take one or two percentage points. But what is most interesting, the various polls indicate that most French people believe that the actual number is actually 30%, and that the projection is that in 2020 it's going to be 40%. So a completely inflated thing. In other words, an issue does exist, but in the popular consciousness, fueled probably by the politicians, by the media, what have you, by terrorism, the perception is, oh my God, we're finished. We've been drowned. We've been invaded. So it's not like we have now a significant minority problem with all the issues of assimilation and, you know, homogenization of the society that comes. But no, this has become a national crisis. And I think this is very significant because across many, this poll was taken across most European countries, and the trend is exactly the same. Whatever the actual numbers are, of Muslim immigrants, whether it's in Sweden or in the Netherlands or in Italy, you know, the popular perception is that the numbers are much, much higher. And hence, if you lace this with what has already been mentioned by my colleagues here, you know, obviously a number of instances of terrorism, including in the last few days. Think of Stockholm, think London, you know, think other events. There is the perception of we are in disarray, and therefore there is a more legitimacy for the forces who claim to want to establish law and order and what have you. And last point, just for your additional comments, is across the board, with the exception of Germany and Scandinavian countries, economic systems on really short breath. France in particular, very low growth, 10.5% unemployment. 10.5%. Okay, you know what the unemployment is in the US? It's 4.5. And people don't feel particularly rich and well off here in the US because unemployment has gone down so significantly on account of the fact that many new jobs are not that good new jobs, they don't pay very well. But imagine what is the situation in France when the unemployment rate is 10.5% and youth unemployment is 20 to 22%, depending on the regions where you are. So there is this sense of, I don't know how to say, of lack of opportunity, economic decline, again, blamed on the immigrants, blamed on Brussels, blamed on what have you. And maybe that's the reason why people want to try their luck with non-traditional political force. Anyway, I'm throwing a few things out for your comment. Any ideas, any thoughts on any of this?
I would maybe first like to go back briefly to the Front National and the way they are seeing as a sort of normal actor in French politics now. And certainly you can trace that back to the political talent of Marine Le Pen for putting a much grander figure than her father, especially for having an economic program that is very protective, not at all like Jean-Marie Le Pen, who did not talk too much about economics anyway, but if he was talking about economics, it was pretty much free economy, regulation, and so on. So classical right theories, if you want. But I would add that she has been helped a lot by people on the center-right who, one after the other, have used her themes. So have given total legitimacy to her approach in order to try to gain the allegiance of her voters. And her dad was famous for saying, French people are no fools. When you give them the choice between the original and the copy, they will always go for the original. So that's what's happening now, I believe. But at the other end, I think that there was last week an incident which might have some impact on the elections, where Marine Le Pen rediscovered her true colors by claiming that the 13,000 Jewish people who had been carried to the sports arena at the time of their leave to be then sent to concentration camps were not being brought there by French police, which they were. She could have added that they were obeying the orders of people in Vichy who are actually the intellectual ancestors of the Front National. I think that she had these little laughs that can remind voters of who actually she really is. Now, on this issue of Europe, I think we are now paying the price for maybe decades where politicians have been blaming Brussels constantly for whatever went wrong and trying to take the benefits of whatever is good for themselves at the national level. And it's really sad that people do not recognize enough of the good that has been brought to the French economy by Brussels. Yes, with more liberalization, but also huge benefits, for example, for French farmers, who ironically are now voting for the National Front, but who have been getting billions of euros through the Common Agricultural Policy, who are the biggest recipients of the benefits of free trade, because they can export their stuff to other countries in Europe and for some products worldwide. So I think there is also mea culpa that should come from the political class in general for at the same time downsizing Brussels, always trying to go for the personalities, secondary personalities, if you want, in the institution of the European Union, and at the same time not wanting to publicize more the huge benefits that have been coming from Brussels. And by the way, I think that in the debates for the runoff, I think the subject of being member or not of the EU is going to be a major subject, because just thinking what it would mean for France to leave the EU in economic terms, that pretty much a nightmarish scenario if there is one.
I also think that Marine Le Pen has a then her style is much more effective, I think, than Marine Le Pen, because we're speaking about high unemployment amongst the youth. I think the youth traditionally vote socialist, if I'm wrong.
More to the left.
Right, more to the left. But now with unemployment at such a high, especially amongst young people, we're finding that she's getting, the opponents and us, getting more support than they traditionally would have in those groups. And I think that also is going to add to her ability to move forward in the polls and to make it possibly to the second round. Now, I don't know what her possibility of if she were to win, which is a big if she were to win, what would be her possibility of gaining the national majority? And I think that's probably not in the cards. But I think that she is. The other point I want to make is that there, and this is just my opinion, that even though she's ahead in the polls, I believe that the possibility of under-reporting of her supporters is very, very real. And if you look at our recent elections, we saw a lot of that with Donald Trump for two reasons. First, I think that there's always been a stigma attached to voting for Latina, although much, much less so now than even a few years ago, just because it has become much more acceptable to voice opinions that were not, they couldn't have been said not too long ago. And secondly, because I think that people who may vote for her are maybe not participating in the polls, just because logistically it's not as common in smaller towns and villages for people to be participating in online polls, talking to pollsters. So it remains to be seen whether that is a fact. I guess we'll be able to tell pretty soon.
Coming back to this question of Front National and why is Marine Le Pen rising much more than her father, I think this is also where lessons or some, let's say, takeaways from the American elections are interesting, and elsewhere in Europe. In fact, what happened in the U.S. this summer is something that Europe has been living already for the at least decade and a half before that, prior to that, which is a phenomenon that a lot of political sociologists have not enough examined in the U.S., which is, in fact, the grafting of identity politics, i.e. themes that are usually proper to the extreme right, with the very deep disenchantment of labor, of working classes. And this has led, in fact, Donald Trump to talk about economic nationalism. He would have talked about economic nationalism if there was no, let's say, this kind of feeling of being orphaned by the labor classes and the working classes that are, in fact, left over by globalization, disindustrialization, and etc. This was happening in Europe. In fact, when you look at the figures of Front National and other extreme right parties in Europe, but mainly Front National since we're talking about France, in fact, the average score of Front National was so far around the 50s, the 15%, 15-18%. The surge to up, to in fact above 20% is only explainable sociologically, if you take the figures, only by the addition to that stock, the original stock, of voters coming from the right, from the left. Meaning that, in fact, and this is a kind of paradox today, in fact, the first, let's say, labor party in France is Front National. Meaning that Front National has replaced, in fact, the Communist Party for a large part. This is not only a French phenomenon. You can see it as elsewhere, but it's very French at the same time. And this, I think, is very important, meaning that in that sense, at least, besides other issues, Marine Le Pen has normalized the discourse of Front National. As you said, usually Front National is on economics, very rightist party, free enterprise. Even, as you said, Jean-Marie Le Pen culturally didn't cater for economy. But now with Marine Le Pen, she has a very strong protectionist economic program that is, in fact, appealing to the working class. This is the first element of normalization. Now, you said something also very interesting and important, I think. What will happen after the election? Because of what you just said, and because of the erosion of the traditional parties, as I said, both of them together are today around 30% only, while when you add the extreme right and the extreme left together, for example, Mélenchon and Le Pen, you are above 45%, meaning that you have a political spectrum where the extremes are no more the extremes in terms of figure. They are the mainstream. And the others are the extremes in terms of figure. Okay? So because of that, and because of what's happening in terms of changes in the sociology and the culture, very probably, even if Marine Le Pen is not elected president of the Republic, Front National is not only a party that is here to stay in the landscape, but my bet is that in the coming local polls, i.e. municipals, regional, département, etc., Front National is becoming probably in the 6-7 years to come the first party in France, which was in fact the place occupied so far by the Socialist Party. The first party in France was the Socialist Party, more than the Republic, more than the right, who was more a upper level political party. In the coming period, I think the Front National will score much more on the municipal and regional level, which means, in fact, that you will have a situation that is odd. You will have a deeply rooted country that is on the extreme right and the political system, which is, in fact, a bit skewed and elsewhere, with all the dangers that come with that. This brings me back to my last point, and this is where I stopped in my first intervention. In fact, the presidential election, the two next rounds on 23 of April and 6 of May are very important. But what is more important probably in terms of governance, in terms of ability to shape things in the future, is the legislative election in June, which is very quickly after that. There is a situation in France twice or three times in the last decade and a half where you had a president of the Republic from one color and a prime minister produced by legislative elections from another political color. This has led to what we call in France cohabitation, which means in fact a gridlock, in fact a coalition government or a coalition between left and right. And given the French political culture and the institutions of the Fifth Republic, it means in fact a political gridlock. Are we heading towards that now? Because if Marine Le Pen is elected, it's not sure that electoral system will give her a majority. If Macron is elected, is not sure that he will have a majority in June. And if Jean-Luc Mélenchon is elected, they definitely will not have a majority in the polls next June. It means that the risk is very high that even whatever the outcome of the presidential election, we will have a system that is in fact very deeply gridlocked and stalemated for institutional reasons is also very high. And this is something that we have to take into account. Now, of course, some people, and I share this view, I belong to this school of thought, says that if, in fact, Marine Le Pen or Macron are elected, the big bang on the presidential level will be so powerful that it will, in fact, probably lead to the explosion of the traditional parties we know, and then you have a recomposition of the entire political landscape, and probably the slow moving of France to a sixth republic, which is in fact a kind of revolution, because every time France moved from one republic to another, it was after episodes of violence. So it would be maybe the first time where we could move slowly and gradually towards something else.
Please. Well, not the last time, not from the fourth to the fifth republic.
The Algeria War is...
Well, it is a consequence of, but it has actually with big impact on the political scene now. I wanted to just come back on two points to illustrate what you said about strengths of the National Front in the labor class. Traditionally, the National Front has been very strong along the southern border of France, along the Mediterranean coast, which is a place where lots of people came back after the independence of Algeria. Lots of animosity towards, obviously, Muslim communities, immigrants, and so on. That was the strong basis of the National Front. But now they have another basis in the northern and eastern France, which used to be bastions of the Communist Party, and where now workers, a lot of them actually not workers anymore, but on the dole, are voting for the National Front. And on the night of her defeat, Marine Le Pen was actually a good chance to become the president of the northern region of France, Nord-Pas-de-Calais. She was beaten at 40% of the votes in the first round, lost because of a coalition between center-right and center-left. And the night of her defeat, she gave a very good speech where she said, "We know now where everybody stands. We are the patriots, and they are the globalists." And by they, she meant center-right and center-left. And actually, in that, she pretty much gave a line to the current president of the United States, because she was the first one to articulate that view.
Thank you. Before we open it to questions from our audience, just one consideration based also on the last comment made by Joseph, that whichever way things turn out, it's going to be most likely it's going to be gridlock. It's not going to be a clean sweep that whether it's France goes to the right or goes to the left, it's going to be a messy affair. And that, I think, again, based on some consideration I made earlier, it's not good for Europe, right? Because we know, and you know, and our audience, probably many Europe experts know, that Europe has been fundamentally this de facto, alliance between France and Germany. And it's really hard to believe that Europe can continue to maintain any momentum, and the momentum is not quite extraordinary at this time, if one of the two main partners, that is France, is prisoner of its own malaise of difficulties, economic difficulties that we've discussed earlier, but also political uncertainty, because you can have President Macron, who doesn't have a majority in parliament, because as you pointed out, he has no political party. He just came like this from nowhere. He has no experience and no pedigree, so to speak. And so that would be his problem. Marine Le Pen, as president, of course, with a dagger at the center of Europe. But again, she may not have a parliamentary majority after all. So be that as it may, it's going to be messy. And therefore, France, whatever its role now, will be even further diminished, and therefore unable to perform this sort of partnership role with Berlin that kind of is the ballast of Europe, such as it is, which shows, or it's a weak ballast, but with France diminished and in the throes of political uncertainty and continuing slow growth, high unemployment problems, immigration and what have you, would make, I think, the future of the whole European enterprise slightly darker, if it is not so bright now. Anyway, with that, let me open to question from the floor. Yes, ma'am. Do we have a microphone? Yes, thank you. If you can please identify yourself, that would be great. Thank you.
Sure. My name is Kim Weigel. I head a small peace-building NGO. So my question is for Joseph. You mentioned that the two mainstream parties represent only a third of the population. So what happens to the other two-thirds of the population? You mentioned parties are eroding. Does that mean they're defunct? Are these people completely independent? Are they not voting? They're turned off? What about two-thirds of the voters?
You're right. The answer we can get a bit later in my second, what I just said. In fact, if you add up Socialist Party and the Republican, it is today a bit around 30%. And if you add extreme left and extreme right, they are a bit of 45%.
Additional to the 30?
Yes. So it means that 45 are the two extreme parties and 30 are the two mainstream, which means, in fact, there is a kind of 15% left, which is floating, that goes here and there, and et cetera, or absentee. So we have a very, I mean, the bottom line of what I wanted to say when I pointed to that is that, in fact, you have growingly, and this is very interesting in terms of constitutional engineering, in fact, you have growingly a disparity or a chasm between a political system, institutional system, or a political offer and a political demand, i.e. political sociology. And this is always a prelude to a kind of constitutional change, because you can't go on like that, the system is strained. So which shape will this constitutional change take? This is the big question. I mean, in France, we are at the fifth change of constitution and republic. It has never been really smooth and easy. It's not like the amendments here in the US or the British constitution that, in fact, doesn't exist, even on paper, which is a customary constitution. In France, there is a political history of change which is not always smooth and rosy. So I don't know what will happen, but definitely, what we know so far is that this kind of landscape cannot go on endlessly. So you mentioned first Mitterrand's supposed sins, which I don't at all share, but let's assume that this is the case. You know, there's a debate, for example, in France, which is technical. If you are like me, a political sociologist, this is what we do every day. You know that there's a very direct correlation between a voting system and the production of political forces. So when, for example, under Mitterrand, the Front National started to rise in the European elections, it crossed the threshold of 10% at that time. Voices started to rise in France that we should, in fact, introduce a kind of proportional voting system in the country because we are no more in a bipartisan system. And of course, in the classical sense of the term, political science, bipartisanism goes along with majoritarian system, and multipartisanism goes with a proportional system. This is what we learn in PSPA 201. Okay, so if you apply PSPA 201 to France today, we should have a proportional system. And this is why I don't share your view. It's not because I'm a staunch supporter of Mitterrand, who a person I like, but I think that if it is true that he had favored the rise of Front National, he would have installed a proportional system that would have put the Front National today at around 30 seats in Parliament, whereby the Front National has 0 seats in Parliament.
It's not French polemics, and I never used the word sin. I look at consequences, which is very different, cause and consequences. And by the way, François Mitterrand did introduce the proportionnel, and it gave this 10% of the votes to the Front National. It's the only time we have proportionnel in France. But he did. And that was part of the reason why I say he favors.
If you have a system that is multi-partisan increasingly, and there is a demand. The demand is more important than the offer. If you have a growing multi-partisan demand, usually the system should evolve towards an offer that is also flexible. This is a technical issue. It's not a partisan
issue. Can I just point to something that is, I mean, not in contradiction with what Joseph says at all, but people have to realize that that goes back actually to what Caesar noticed when he wrote about this war in Gaul, that there are so many tribes in Gaul, which is now France. And if you let French people out of the current voting system that we have, you have very quickly 25 parties. And actually, in the last European elections, there were 25 parties. There are actually 11 candidates in the presidential election. I know three of them personally. Two of them are certified nuts, but
they run, and they have run one. It's the fifth time that he runs, I believe. So,
thank you.
Paolo, if you allow, you asked about how to vote and if they will vote. I think there are two points at play here that we haven't really talked very much about. One is the undecided voter, and the other is abstention. I think the last I read was a third of voters are not decided yet on how they're going to come down at the end. And that, there's no way to tell how that's going to work out until it actually happens. The other thing is that there's a whole group of people who are so disgusted with, you know, an election that is kind of a circus. It's viewed as kind of a circus going on right now. To the point where they're just not going to come out. They're just not going to vote. And so we don't really know how. I think it's impossible to tell at this point whether how the undecided voters will go. What I think is that the people who are undecided and who are more inclined to vote Front National will probably do that, but it's hard to tell other than that which way people are going to go at the end.
Thank you. Please, sir, and then lady, and this gentleman.
Hi.
Please.
I'm Andrew McManus, MBA student here at BAU International. I have two questions. First question, we mentioned about immigration and how immigrants affect the previous election and what's going to be their role for this election. My second question is about the foreign policy and how this again affects all the politicians in France look at their foreign policy, especially with this era. And this is escalating for all the war either in Syria or North Korea, or what's going to happen very soon in Libya. If anything will happen, another flooding of immigration will move to Europe and especially France. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good questions, immigration and foreign policy. Who wants to tackle?
Sir? So on immigration, could you you want to have an idea of an idea of the impact of immigration, or
what was their impact in the previous election, and what's going to happen for this election?
Okay. Simple issue. No, I mean, I don't think that. The question of immigration is probably not the same in France now as it is in, say, Germany or other Central European countries, where people are much more concentrating on the possible inflow of refugees. And not that many refugees who come to France, sadly. They don't come to France because they don't see economic opportunities in France. They go to Germany because there is work to be found there. So the question of immigration in France is more the question of, it's not even immigrants, it's second generation citizens of France, but who have difficulties integrating and so on. And in that sense, I think that Joseph mentioned it, but the impact of the many terrorist attacks, but the three big ones in Paris, Charlie Hebdo, then on Bataclan, and the soccer stadium and Nice have had a big impact. I'm not sure that what would happen in this country if you had the three same events year after year. And having been there in 2001, I would not like to be around this country if we had the same type of horrific attacks. Foreign policy, I don't think it's really a major issue in the campaign. What's really intriguing is that there are way too many candidates who seem to like Mr. Putin a lot. National Front, Mr. Fillon, people seem to, Mélenchon, of course, that's his inheritance from the Communist Party, USSR, International, and so on. But too many people seem to enjoy spending their time off in Moscow.
Just a quick word, maybe. It's an important element, but I think your question was much more, if I understood you well, what is the voting tendency of immigrants or people who are, in fact, which is an oxymoron because immigrants don't vote, but I mean naturalized immigrants like myself, for example. First of all, it's very difficult in France, and this is a particularity of the system in France. You can't, by law, have polls that are based on ethnic belongings, which is different with the US, for example. You can't ask someone, are you a Muslim, are you an African? First question, second question, how do you vote? This is forbidden by law. You can infer that with a lot of statistical issues and etc. But let me say that impressionistically, I mean very vaguely, usually the second generation, as you said, tended to vote on the left, usually, traditionally, of course, which is normal. That's like the Irish and the Jews in, or the Italians in the US voted for the Democratic Party. But this is also something that is changing with political culture, with a lot of things that are odd to explain by classical meaning. For example, people from the third, second generation of Islamic descent or Arabic descent or etc. that are sometimes tempted to vote for National, which is something very strange. It's not statistically very important, but you see that. I think that this election, more than any other election, will have this unknown. We don't know, first of all, how much will be the participation, and this is a huge unknown. The second unknown is to which part of the political spectrum they will go. But what we know so far is that a lot of them has deserted the traditional parties to which they usually tended to vote, like, for example, the Socialist Party. So who will inherit the sociology of state? If this is your question.
Yes, thank you.
I think that the second and third generation, I agree that they tend to vote to the left. But I think in this election, they are probably the most at risk to not vote this time. Because the Socialist Party has sort of, I don't want to say irrelevant, but the current president has been viewed sort of as an indecisive, not very forceful or presidential politician. And so the Socialists are there. I don't want to say that it's going to be the end of the Socialist Party, but I do feel that children of immigrants and grandchildren of immigrants will, in this election specifically, will be less inclined to support their traditional parties.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am. Microphone, please.
Hello. Thank you for the presentation. I am a Venezuelan and a Spanish citizen. And then also I am an English student at Mentora School. I have two questions. In my own experience as a Latin American citizen, especially being from Venezuela, and then thinking globally, because I think the world is global, I wonder what opposition movement against racism and extremism are not doing well. Why they are not capture the attention of the people? You know? From my own experience, I can see the risk for right citizens and for everybody, you know, what the problem around here. And then the second question is, in some way, the reaction, the rising of nationalism can be understood like a reaction of the way as economic globalization has been designed and implemented.
Who would like to tackle this?
Well, I would speak a little bit about racism in France. I think it has been present the entire time I've been. I started going to France in the 90s and the early 2000s, and racism has always been a part of the culture. I recently had a conversation with the president of one of the major museums in Paris, and he told me that racism in France is not so much racism as economic discrimination. So it doesn't look the way that it looks here. And in a way that allows people to accept it more easily, because it's not so much I don't like who you are. It's more it's more that people who become successful, people who become good citizens, are not going to be discriminated against. But if you have no money and you don't work and you're unemployed, you live in one of the housing schemes specifically designed for poor people, but that tend to be full of immigrants, you're excluded from society. And that's something that I've witnessed myself and thought. It did remind me in many ways about the way that racism exhibits itself here in the United States. Although they don't think, the average French person doesn't really think that racism is a big problem. But if you talk to people who are in minority, the people who are ethnic and religious minorities, they feel completely different about it. But I think it's also important to note that, and I wrote about this recently, a man who was accosted in the metro, and it was a very aggressive and racist incident. And he went home and never said anything to anyone. It never occurred to him to make a protest or to make any sort of a statement. I think it's just much more a part of life that people deal with, people on the receiving end deal with, and people who are not on the receiving end don't really acknowledge the full impact, the full extent of it.
Yeah, I would like to think even more pessimistic than Michele is on racism, because I think unfortunately it's alive and well. And for having spent recently 5 years in Germany, in Berlin, I blame part, at least, of racism on the fact that France refused to confront its past during the Second World War and the Vichy government. And actually, until very recently, and it's still apparently controversial, refused to acknowledge the responsibility of French people in what had happened at a time where, it's very clear, majority of French people were highly supportive of the Vichy regime and its policy. I think for what looked at the time like good reasons, it was one of General de Gaulle's decision to throw a veil over the whole thing. But I think it's ultimately a mistake because people are not conscious of their history. And if you are not conscious of the history, you are likely to repeat your mistakes.
I want to talk a little bit about North Africa and the history of colonialism in France, which is not something, the damage done in those areas of North Africa are not really acknowledged. Taking property and assault and I think that that's not something that's really present in the French consciousness, and it has a direct impact, I think, on, although it was a long time ago, it has a direct impact on the relationships between those of North African descent and the way that they relate to people of French descent. I find that it is almost impossible to become French, no matter how many generations you've been in the country. You're, when people talk casually, they, you know, here we have African American and British American, and in France people refer to people as African or, you know, Arab or Algerian, even if they were born in France and their parents were born in France. Well, then, well, you know, you can't compare American culture and French culture, but the impossibility of becoming French, of being French, when your ancestry is from some other part of the world, is extremely frustrating. And also, the idea that these communities live completely differently, are sequestered sort of out of the way of, you know, out of the view of the bon français, it's not a problem that the average person is going to be thinking of. They think, well, you know, I like Arab music and the food's really great. It's a sort of a romanticized a view of the culture that is not the reality of the people who live it, who are in depressed areas, who really see no
colonization, and said this is a French crime, which is in fact a complete contradiction to the fact that no one is acknowledging. He lost more than 3 or 4 points in the polls. Which means that the popular opinion is not ready to that, but it means also that there are people in France who are ready to open this subject and talk about it. So this is something that has to be said, because I'm a bit sometimes tired to hear that France is almost a kind of racist system. This is not South Africa during the apartheid. It's strong. France has its flaws and its weaknesses, but this is not it. I mean, that's not exaggerating also. So you have the issue of economics, and then you have something else which is new today, which is insecurity and terrorism. I mean, it's very difficult today to approach the issue of integration or assimilation or adaptation of migrants from a Muslim, I'll be very open and frank, of a Muslim Arab descent, when you have on the TV screens every day ISIS 70% of the time occupying the landscape. I mean, put yourself in the shoes of, I mean, we are more or less, I mean, we are university students and graduates and etc. We can understand it. But if you put yourself in the shoes of a miner or a factory worker in Dunkirk or etc., for him the migrant who's coming from Iraq, Syria, Pakistan or Mali is an ISIS terrorist in becoming. So it's of course false, but some politicians are playing on that, and unfortunately the world climate is not helping to that. So you have also this additional problem. And this is why, for me at least in this election, this is one of the stakes that are in the political debate. So this is why you have people like Marine Le Pen or others going very far on that level. I mean, if you listen to Marine Le Pen, it's a bit more than under the presidential campaign here. Every Arab in France is an ISIS terrorist in potential. So this is something very, very, very unhealthy also. So I think that these factors help explain, if you want, why we have this issue of difficulty of assimilation. Last point on the foreign policy, and this is an answer to your question, and you said it. It's not also a coincidence that you have, and I'm not here entering in a polemical debate. I mean, of course, I think that what I'm saying gives you an idea of where do I stand politically, but technically, concretely, we have proofs of the fact that, for example, in French election, like in German election, like in Brexit, like in other elections, There is someone called Vladimir Putin sitting in Moscow and playing with the fate of ballots, with playing with ballots and with the fate of elections, and seeking to undermine the unity of Europe. And playing on that, he uses the issue of migration, he uses the issue of Islamophobia, he uses the issue of insecurity, and etc. And this is a very huge factor of foreign policy intruding in the election. Yes, it is true that French people, like the Americans, will not vote in function of foreign policy. It's maybe 10% of the people who will look at the very thin chapter in the program about foreign policy, but foreign policy has become a factor because of the voting, mingling in the voting process. And this is something which is foreign policy as such.
Thank you. We have time maybe for a couple more questions. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Zaria Kadafi. I'm a teacher. I have a comment and a question. So my first comment, just to kind of piggyback off what Ms. Leiby said, and then what the other gentleman said, she was talking about how you can never become French. And you said, oh, yes, there's the Spanish people, Portuguese people, Italian people who become French. But I think it's in you. I think it's important to note that these are white nationalities already. So, yes, it's easier. It happened the same in North America. It used to be that Irish and Italians were considered other, and then eventually they just became white and American, and it was everyone else who had a harder time assimilating. So I think it's important to note that when we talk about someone saying, can I become part of your nationality, it's when I look different, when I look Asian or black, can I become part of your nationality? And I just wanted to point that out, because that's pretty obvious to me as an African-American woman. And then my question, which can be answered by anyone on the panel, is, does anyone think there is actually a feasible way, a sustainable way, and is there even a model in the world today of a nation being economically viable in this globalized world and still remaining isolationist and nationalist? Like, is that even doable today? Can you even survive?
May I take this just my own little privilege here? If I try to tackle this last point, this is really mission impossible that you described, because in talking about the economic issues you just pointed out, can you have globalized? Can you develop harmoniously and have growth except in isolation? No, it's not possible. On the other hand, globalization, at least some aspects of globalization, are at the source of the plight of the middle class in Europe and the United States. Because what happened in the 1980s and 1990s and at the cross of the millennium is that you had a few hundreds of millions of Asian workers that came into the global workforce without any additional demand for labor. And that simply meant that the jobs went to them because they were cheaper. And that was made possible by globalization, by the fact that those laborers had better education, more skills, and they were willing to work hard for low wages. Add to that the advantages of interconnected or superconnected societies, thanks to the internet, to fiber optic cables, to outsourcing, and the ability to develop supply chains, and what have you, and you got what you got. That is, the jobs have gone from here to there. That's a permanent displacement. So that's a bad result of globalization. But is the opposite true? That is, if you raise walls, and if you say no protection, taxation, tariffs at the border, that all of a sudden things turn out fine? Absolutely not. So here we have a sense of a no-win situation, that Western societies have to, in a sense, reinvent themselves in ways that we're not quite sure how they're going to turn out, because these shifts have already taken place. Add to that technology and automation, and that doesn't look very good for the future of manufacturing jobs and other jobs that can be or will be for sure automated. So the common sense answer would be that we have to all cooperate, have open borders, etc. But we don't have, as much as we would like to say that we do, the rules of the game for this brave new world. We simply don't. What has happened is a lowering to the lowest common denominator, which is that those who are the low-cost providers get the business. And that means a global shift of employment and resources and capital investments from what used to be, you know, the first world to what is the newcomers, mostly in Asia, to some extent in Latin America, but it's really mostly in Asia. And that, therefore, makes it an incredibly large challenge. And I, quite frankly, maybe my colleagues have different opinions, but I find it hard to, as much as I try to think about these issues, to find a, oh, this is the solution to this. But please, if you have different thoughts, articulate them.
And try to articulate. I would agree on one point, which is that for too long there has been a sort of mantra, in particular here as part of the Washington Consensus, that trade liberalization was just the nicest thing in the world. It would only bring good things to everybody, and that's not true. And that speech is changing a bit. However, I would like to point out that most economists agree that most of the job losses are due to automation, not to trade. That's a very important factor. And for having spent 5 years there, I know one country with open borders which benefits a lot from globalization, and it's Germany. And it's Germany because they manufacture at very high cost, because most workers are unionized, very good products that sell the world over. And when I talk here to people who invest in manufacturing and sometimes want to go to Mexico, they tell me they want to go to Mexico because they have, yes, cheaper labor, but mostly they have better labor. They have people who are trained, who are willing to go to work every day, who sadly don't have drug problems, and it's the reason why they want to go there. So it's a complex landscape, and please don't blame it all on trade.
Well, I just gotta say, I mean, I'm right there with you. It's the technology age, the industrial age, it's wrapping up. And we can't, how do these working class societies and stuff think that somehow by closing borders or something that's going to get them jobs back? Like, how can anyone sell that?
Yes.
It's like selling ice to an ex-Eskimo or something.
Yeah. Well, it worked well. It worked well.
We've seen some results of that.
It can be sold, but well, how can you then deliver the product? You can sell it.
That's the thing.
How can you deliver it?
Well, the thing is that people deliver the promise, right? That if you leave it up to me, I'll take care of it, and I know, and I'm smart, and I renegotiate everything. I mean, I'm maybe, you know whom I'm talking about. so that's the way it works. And in France, certainly, and elsewhere in Europe, the rise of these conservative, right-wing, anti-immigrant, anti-Europe political forces bank on the fact that they seem to believe that if we get rid of Europe, if we get rid of the euro, if we have regained our national sovereignty, if we can do things on our own, somehow things take care of themselves, which is a myth. I don't really think that, as bad as the current arrangement may be, and it's certainly not brilliant, the solutions proposed are worse than the disease, in my, and I think probably we concur on this. So, and indeed, if you add to that the other problem, which I don't know that we have a fix on, and that is the relentless pace of automation, which will simply mean the disappearance of traditional jobs. We have had the good luck in the industrialized world that as jobs disappeared in the countryside, we had industrialization, and therefore we had mass production and we can move agricultural laborers, which are redundant, into the cities and work for factories. And this is a kind of ability of capitalism to reinvent itself and to shift manpower from one place to another, kind of made things manageable. Now we are coming into a situation which we don't really know what the new frontiers of employment are. So, I mean, we're kind of going into a different direction now, but just to try to explain some at least of the dynamics, these are not the only dynamics, but I think there's a challenge. And certainly, as Jean-François just said, there are countries that seem to manage quite well, thank you very much, and that is Germany and others. And maybe you can add the Scandinavian countries that certainly have a much better organized societies capable of absorbing change and transformation and retraining and retooling and enhancing their education systems so that this makes them capable of meeting the challenges of globalization and whatnot. Any further thoughts? Mr. Ambassador, yes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I would like to thank also our panel member for the brilliant presentation. My name is Dr. Mohammed Nasser Hassan. I'm a judge in the public United States. But I would like to say that I'm here not as an ambassador, but as an academician. So having said that, I would like just to make a comment. I think in the past, all the electors based their choice on ideology of the parties. From the left, so I will vote left candidate, and from the right, I will vote right candidate. But the new generation today, that's not the case. They base their election on two key issues. One is the economy. I mean by economy that who gonna present us a very good economic plan that will allow the people to have jobs, good jobs and better life. The second point is the issue of security. As far as we have good jobs and better life, we should live in a peaceful environment. So the issue of security is very important also for electors. So, I think as we can learn from American election also, I'm the one who said, contrary of the other colleague, I said, Trump will win only because he said, I will reduce tax, and I will bring you back your jobs. And this is the French proverb, trop d'impôts tue l'impôt. That means if you increase a lot of tax, you will lose tax by losing the companies. When you lose companies, you will lose the revenue, you will lose jobs. So I think in France, I don't know today the different program, Marine Le Pen and others, but the French people will not make an exception. They will base also their election on the security and better jobs and better lives. The second comment I would like to make, and I would not be surprised if there will be another cohabitation in France, because the cohabitation at that time, it had been made to solve a problem. What's the problem? You have a party who control the executive, president is for the party, and all the power controlled by the opposition. So the country will be blocked. To overcome that this France will be broke, they come out with the idea of cohabitation, president from a party, and the prime minister from an opposition party to cohabitate and let French move forward. Thank you very much.
Comments?
Maybe very, very, very quickly. I think on the economic question, I think that we are in this sort of classic situation in developed economies where you have really two worlds. You have multinational companies. Whose business is mostly outside of
their country of origin, in that particular case, France, and which do recognize that their market is international. You know, one of the arguments that was made here by the former administration for the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement was that, A, we have only 5% of the population. We need to go outside of our borders to find markets. If that's true for the U.S., it's even more true for France or for any European country for that matter. On the political situation post the presidential election, I can think of one precedent where actually a president came from what was at the time a marginal party, this president Giscard d'Estaing, who was the head of a small party, part of the center-right coalition, Républicain Indépendant, and who, once he was elected, was able to assemble very quickly a majority that supported him. And I think we could see the same type of scenario. That's basically because I want to be an optimistic man.
Yes, sir.
Quick question. Microphone.
Thank you. I'm Andrew Weiner. I'm the Dean of Graduate Studies here at BAU. And it's a quick question with a long answer. Can you distinguish between the policies of Geert Wilders, Marine Le Pen, and, say, Viktor Orban?
The first one?
Geert Wilders in Netherlands.
Yes, of course.
I'm sure I'm the best position because I'm not an expert on Front National. One thing is that it is worrying to see the same tendencies in different European countries, and I was especially personally alarmed by what I saw in the Netherlands, which has a totally different history and so on. And I saw that people were over-enthusiastic about the fact that he lost, but he got a lot of votes. So it's not that reassuring. But I would also, I think, like to stress the fact that I think history matters a lot. And there are different histories in different countries. The Front National has a sort of intellectual genealogy, if you want, that goes back to end of the 19th century in France. There is one thinker whose name is Moras, who apparently is the darling of Mr. Bannon across the street. National has had, or rather their ancestors, have exercised responsibilities in the government of France in the 40s. And I personally hope, I'm not neutral on the matter, that French voters remember that.
Many thanks. I thank all of you. I thank Michel, Jean-Francois, and Joseph for your kind participation to our discussion. I hope that this was enlightening, although this is a really complex issue, both in France and if we look beyond France and the rest of Europe. Somewhat disheartening, I guess. There's not exactly much positive to say about the
the current evolution, but this is what's going on, and I think it is our duty here to try to illustrate and present things as they're happening. So with that, I would like to thank all the participants, our panelists, and hope to see you at our next event. Thank you. Bye-bye.